Hello, everyone, and welcome to another podcast of The Raw Men. Tonight, we're talking to Jonathan Stewart. He's a lecturer in cultural history in the United Kingdom. I saw him give a presentation in Manchester at QED last year and was very impressed. We're going to be talking about his presentation on the contemporary solutions to alcoholism and why Alcoholics Anonymous is blocking those alternatives. Mr. Stewart, how do you do, sir?
Hello, Aaron. Thank you so much for having me on your podcast. I'm on your show. I'm a big fan, so thank you.
Well, my pleasure. I very much enjoyed your presentation, and one of the sticking points for me was, and I mean, a lot of people have people that they know, people that are close to them that that deal with this problem if they don't deal with that problem themselves. And of course, in my family, in my circle of friends, I know of a few people who could use some real help in this area. And one time I got a call from someone I know very well, but he's just not somebody that shares my perspective on life. In other words, he's one of those unquestioned Christians. Mm-hmm. And he was asking me for, you know, what advice could he have on dealing with his own alcoholism. He was having it was a particularly low part in his life. And it was a frustrating thing because I didn't know the name of the drug that you were talking about. I don't think it was available in the United States. I don't know that it still is. We'll be talking about that momentarily. But I was trying to tell this guy that, you know, when he wants to go to Alcoholics Anonymous and everything, and I tell him ultimately, there is no you know, magical solution coming from a higher power. It just, there never is. And that ultimately, without chemical assistance, the only thing that you can do to beat a problem with any kind of an addiction is really your ability to walk away from that. It all comes down to your own willpower, so far as I see it. That's what it appears to be, that if you ever break any addiction, and the only experience I have with this is smoking, you know, they have this saying that you're only a puff away from a pack a day.
Yeah.
And yeah. That seems to be the case for me. I didn't smoke for a really long time. It was, you know, like a dozen or so years or so. I started as an adult, you know, like 24 years old when I picked up smoking. Everybody else I know started 10 years earlier than that. So I guess I have an advantage over most people. I did eventually stop, but I remember going through this period where, you know, you're fighting that physical need. It was a very difficult thing for me to do. And it was very embarrassing for me to admit that I had an addiction to anything, that I could be beaten, or, you know, that I was under the control of some other thing. And I remember finally when I got to like a month without a single cigarette, I remember taking a puff off of a cigarette and thinking then that it was like giving a blowjob to an exhaust pipe. I mean, I couldn't believe that I was doing this willingly for so many years. Only then did I understand that this is actually pure poison. And this is the only reason that it has this kind of a, you know, euphoric effect, is you're literally poisoning yourself. And that was, I could smoke cigars on occasion and have that only be an occasional thing and not have it be a habit. And eventually I gave up those completely too. But I knew that if I ever sat down and smoked a cigarette, I'd be hooked again.
It's really interesting, the whole dynamics of addiction, because there's a lot of illnesses that science has done a great deal to help us with. Some have been eradicated completely. Smallpox used to dominate society, even the United States at the time of independence. And today it's almost unknown. It's kind of kept in the virus is kept in a vault, isn't it? And polio has nearly been eradicated, apart from a few areas of Pakistan and Afghanistan. But the idea that what strikes me as interesting is that addiction and alcoholism is a massive, massive problem. Something like 6% of deaths around the world are to do with alcohol alone. And we just landed a European Space Agency just landed a camera on a passing asteroid and sent pictures back to Earth. This thing's traveling at however many thousand miles an hour, and it's the size of a large rock, and we landed a camera on it and sent pictures back to Earth, and we can't do more yet to cure alcoholism and addiction. And I think that's largely because Alcoholics Anonymous does work, but it helped me. I've been sober for a little bit over 15 years, nearly 14 of those in AA. And it does work, because what it does is that difficulty you described of making that decision not to have the first puff, it kind of kills that off for you. It gets rid of it by rewiring your faulty control mechanism, basically. And that's what a fictional higher power does for you. In that respect, it's very effective. It works two ways. It rewires a faulty control mechanism, and the other thing it does that's quite clever is the group thing. So it enforces groupthink very, very well. And when you go to the meetings, there's a famous psychological experiment where they draw different length lines on the wall, and everybody in the experiment is in on it, apart from one person who's the actual subject, and everybody pretends the middle line is the longest line. And 70% of the times, you'll agree with the group, even if you know that you're not picking the correct answer. That's called the Ash conformity experiment. And AA is basically a massive Ash conformity experiment where everybody goes, there is a God, and it's going to help me stay sober. And then the higher power essentially takes over that faulty self-control mechanism. It's very effective, and it works, but not for the reasons stated. And that's what I think is really interesting, is that it's only because it's effective that AA is so huge. It's about 2 million people worldwide, most of whom in the United States, about 1.5 million. And around 10 million people in the last 80 years have been helped. But unfortunately, it's meant that because we have this kind of sticking plaster, it's meant that science hasn't really been motivated to do that much about it. Because everybody knows, as you just described, if you have a drink problem, you go to AA. And there's quite complex social reasons behind that as well, to do with control over media. There's quite a few people who are actively campaigning against AA, who've had various stories and films sort of stopped. There's a lot of AA in the media because everybody's anonymous. So there's a lot of anonymous actors and TV producers and those kind of people that are making sure. I don't know if you've seen the sitcom Mom, that's been out for a while. That's basically an AA sitcom. There's another one starting on ABC, Road to Recovery, or Recovery Road, or whatever it's called. I mean, it's huge. It's everywhere. It's in movies. It's in Finding Nemo. They have a little AA meeting under the sea amongst the fish. It's in Wreck-It Ralph. The cartoon characters have a AA meeting. And there are hundreds and hundreds of anonymous style recovery groups, from food addicts to cocaine addicts. So it's kind of become the 20th century recovery meme. And what's happening is, effectively, it's because it's now so successful, it's blocking potential change. And because everybody's so emotionally invested in it, as you described, you know, everybody has somebody that they know that they'd really like to help, or somebody is maybe in trouble and doesn't want to admit that they have a problem, they're in denial. And other people do feel they've been helped by it, so they're super defensive of it. Certainly when I was in AA, I would have been extremely defensive of it, because it works.
I don't know that these methods would necessarily work on me, because I think I'm oblivious. I think that's my problem. For example, I just sat down to speak with somebody that I knew was a recovered alcoholic, and I'm sitting here with a giant tankard of beer.
That's cool. I've noticed it.
I don't know why it didn't even occur to me as I'm pouring my collar that this is the show, and maybe that would be inappropriate.
Don't worry. That's the definition of recovered, though. If I'm bothered by that, I'm not really recovered. So I've got my cup of, it's a lot later here. I've got my cup of hot chocolate, so I'm okay with that.
Now, I know some people that, I know one person in particular whose situation is, he outdrinks everybody, has been a heavy duty alcoholic for like forever, and will not seek assistance, does not will not admit that there's a problem. You know, marriage broke up because of it, lost jobs because of it, all of the major issues that you get from alcoholism he's had, and simply won't even attempt to go on the wagon, to go straight. There's always some excuse why he's going to go ahead and come off the wagon tonight, mm-hmm. just like he did last night, just like he did the night before. And simply say that, I can't stop. Now, I've heard people say, I'm not addicted. I can quit at any time. I've said that myself, but it was true when I said it. But he simply says that he can't, that there's nothing mm-hmm. that could ever help him. What do you suggest? And I'm really concerned because this is a major issue in this person's life. And I would love, as would everybody else who still cares about this guy, I would love to be able to help him to do something with it. Because as far as I see it, there's two versions of this person. There's the one that is one of my oldest and best friends for decades. And then there's the version that is unintelligible and can't function. And is if you come over and he's in that way, you want to leave immediately because there's no point in staying around. He can't do anything.
Well, there's several options, and in a lot of ways, there's never been a better time to seek help for this kind of thing. Bizarrely, if he's local to you, he's kind of disadvantaged because if he was in the UK or in Canada, in some parts of the States, there are some quite strong atheist chapters of Alcoholics Anonymous. And there's no question that group support is helpful in recovery. So my first suggestion would be to seek out an atheist group of AA.
Well, that's another problem. He's not atheist either. That's
well. In that case, he could just it's tricky because although I no longer attend and I'm supporter of other means of recovery and I like to publicize them. Part of the problem is this huge sort of elephant in the room, which is the 1.5 million sober people in the United States who meet regularly, who he could sit and hang out with for half an hour. So that would be I always recommend that first because it's what worked for me. But there's lots of other things too. There's the Sinclair method, which is a pill that's been around for a very long time called naltrexone. There's a couple of different variations on it. Nalmefene and naltrexone, and it's been used with varying success to help people with addictions. And then an American doctor called David Sinclair found out that if you take it an hour before you drink, it cuts off the reward mechanism, so you get a pleasant sensation from it, but you don't get the raging high from alcohol that people with a drink problem get, which is why they drink the way they do, because their reward systems are over.
Let me ask a question just for my own clarity. Now I'm talking about somebody that drinks very, very heavily, who has several beers just to begin with and then shifts to, Jaeger's wine, like a box of wine and then a bottle of something else, hard liquor, and it'll be all in one evening. So when we talk about taking this pill an hour before you drink and it stops this reward pattern, well, what's to stop him from continuing the indulgence beyond where he normally would?
I think the theory is that you just don't see the point. You have the couple of drinks. I'm following a guy at the moment who's doing exactly this. And for anybody who's interested, I'm sure there's plenty of people that have tried all kinds of different things. And this thing's called the Sinclair method, and you can. There's a website called C3 Foundation. C, the letter C, 3, the number 3.
I'll make sure to put a link.
It's a fantastic organization, and it's brand new. It's real ground floor stuff, and there are certain reasons why it's not getting out there the way that it should. But essentially, what it does is, the reason why he drinks more is because he has an overreactive reward system. So one's too many and 1,000's not enough. So he could just have this, what this pill does. Apparently, I've never taken it because I'm abstinent. What the pill does is it essentially cuts off that motor that you turn on that goes, right, I've started this, so I'm going to finish the thing no matter what. And then I'm going to go and get some more. it just cuts that off. And what it does is it re-educates your pathways, so you become your alcoholism gets chemically extinguished. And there's an interesting parallel with what happens in AA, which is the opposite. Your alcoholism gets worse. Even if you go into meetings, the saying is, my disease is doing push-ups in the parking lot. And it builds up this terrible thing when people do have a relapse. They go all out because they've got a head full of AA and a belly full of beer, and they've been told they have an incurable disease, and one drink means they're going to finish drink the whole liquor store dry. And that's what happens. And what this does is the opposite. It cuts off that reward mechanism, and you re-educate your brain over time, and eventually you become a normal drinker, or you get bored and stop altogether. And I think anybody who's suffering with a drink problem, they're often in denial because they don't feel they can do it. They don't feel that they can stop. I certainly didn't. I was an atheist, and I had to have a full-on religious conversion before I'd stop. Fortunately, I'm an atheist again now. But I would have loved it
you had to resort to religion?
Yeah, man, I was desperate. I had a very successful decade in the 1990s. I had hit records and was did everything I'd ever wanted to do. Lived in America, worked in music, and I ended up seeking help towards the end of that decade, going to AA and just thinking, well, that's never going to work for me because they all believe in God, and there's so much God in the steps and everything. And then 2 years later, I was just at a rock bottom, met a guy, it went back to AA, met a guy who was in science. So I thought, you have a sponsor in AA who helps you through the steps. I thought, I'll get a scientist to sponsor me. He won't believe in God. And I got a scientist who does believe in God. And he gradually persuaded me that there is a higher power helping me stay sober. And I'm a full-on naturalist. If I can't observe it, it doesn't exist kind of guy. And in AA, you get a lot of sayings like, there's no such thing as coincidence. That's God helping you stay sober. And enough of those things happen to you, and you're in a desperate enough situation, you're pretty vulnerable. I developed a genuine faith, and it lasted for about 12 years till I started watching certain podcasts that I shouldn't have watched, like yours and The Thinking Atheist and other ones like that. Oh, well, what happened was I read The God Delusion. And this is the difference now. Someone like yourself, someone like me in 2000, who's a sort of a fairly kind of thinks they're an atheist but is in trouble with booze. 15 years ago, you could say to someone, look, just give the God thing a go because otherwise you're going to die. Today, you couldn't do that. I've seen Andrew Thompson's amazing YouTube film, Why We Believe in Gods. And I started watching that as a person of faith. And I ended the 45-minute lecture back as an atheist again. And I thought, I would, if someone said to me now, just find a little chink of light or you're going to drink and die, I'd be like, well, I'm afraid I'm going to drink and die because there is no God. Because we now know that I'm sort of pretty much an anti-theist now, I think. And so for someone, if your friend has any faith, then I think, you know, that could possibly help him. But all along, here's the irony, right? All along, I was trying to get sober since the mid-90s. And naltrexone's been licensed since about 1995. So it's been around for 20 years.
It's only available, as you said, in the United Kingdom and in
Canada. No, it's available in the United States. It's available in lots and lots of countries. No one knows about it.
So naltrexone.
Yeah, naltrexone and nalmefene. Yeah.
Is available in the United States right now.
As far as I'm aware, yes. And there are websites dedicated to people finding it. And you have to hunt for them, but they are around there.
Okay, so since we've mentioned that it's available, and you've mentioned kind of a generality of it, you know, in how it works, is there anything you can add sure. for people who want to look this up?
Yeah, I would go on the thing is called C3 Foundation, and they have a whole guide on how to use it, where to get it from, And they also offer free counseling as well, because what they want is for people to be doing this. And there's quite a movement in the United Kingdom amongst people like myself who are not, I'm just in favor of people getting well. I don't care how they do it. And I think there are methods that should be better known that are more suited to atheists as well, because I live in a godless nation. And so there's a lot of people trying to publicize this thing now. And ideally, what would be great is if someone who's like an actor or a sports star who had trouble with drink found sobriety using naltrexone. Because what happens is, for a lot of people, is they just get bored of drinking and they just stop. Some people are instant responders. I'm not sure what the statistic is, but it's something like 20% of people, literally their brain just goes, you know what, I've had enough. And here's the thing for your friend who doesn't think he can stop. Like I didn't think I could stop. I had to sort of find a God who doesn't exist in order to do it. If he takes this pill and he's one of those people who's an instant responder, the pill does the work for him. And he's just like, wow, I could stop after all. And he can get control of his life again, and through medication and science. Hey, you know, and the doctor was an American guy working in Finland, and it's been used in Finland. The reason why he's in Finland is because that's where the biggest research labs are that use rats and mice to experiment on alcoholism and addiction. So he works over there, and this thing's been used in Finland for a long time now, very, very many years, and thousands of people have been helped. And it has an overall success rate, supported by peer review, of about 78%.
Well, once again, if you'll provide me the appropriate links, I'll be happy
to put them in the description. Sure, yeah, absolutely, yeah. Whereas AA's success rate depends on when you start measuring it, but it's pretty low. I mean, most people, if you end up in a rehab, they'll tell you quite honestly, you know, 3% of you guys will make it. I have a friend who is in rehab. He was in a group of 20, and in his first session, the counselor said, one of you 20 people sit here will make it through this process and be sober a year from now. But what kind of statistic is that? And people go back and back and back to rehab. And this system has been tested in Finland quite carefully, and seems to have something like 75-78% long-term success rate.
Yeah,
which means controlling the drinking, and for many people, just stopping.
Yeah. I have to tell you, if it wasn't for my issue with having once been a smoker, you know, with dealing with cigarettes, I wouldn't understand anything about chemical dependency at all. I wouldn't about, you know, addiction. I wouldn't have any concept of it. You know, I needed that one episode of my life. I lost a friend less than a year ago over heroin. Mm. And so one of my oldest and dearest friends died of a heroin addiction. And of course, you can imagine what that did to destroy his life before that point. You know, I don't know if it's related, but I mean, I wouldn't have been able to understand anything at all about where he's coming from if I didn't have that one addiction that was so hard for me to beat. I mean, it wasn't something that I could just put down and stop and walk away from. And I had to make several attempts. And it was ultimately what I think worked for me was my own disgust at my own failure was the only reason that I succeeded. I should tell you something about myself on, you know, the drinking thing in relation to Alcoholics Anonymous. I met a girl who was attending these AA meetings, and she invited me to come with her. I did. And I attended one meeting, and it was a very bothersome thing, because nowadays, I mean, I will seek out like this is a local craft beer, and it's a quite good one. I will drink frequently. I drink only good stuff, and it has been years since I've been drunk. You know, and I just don't get drunk. I don't drink enough to get drunk. I mean, I don't drink for that purpose. I actually drink stuff that my friends once upon a time would be confused about. They said, you don't drink beer to get drunk. And I said, no, you don't drink the crap that you drink, you know, you don't drink beer to, for the taste of it. That's what they were saying. You don't drink beer for the taste of it. Yes. I drink what I drink for the taste of it. I wouldn't drink the crap that you have for the taste of it. You're just trying to get drunk. And when you're drinking something that's only 5% alcohol, you're still going the wrong route. So American beer, you should just wander away from. unless it's one of the new craft beers, because we do actually make some good craft beer now. As I said, nowadays I drink frequently, but I don't ever get drunk. And at this time of my life, when I attended an Alcoholics Anonymous meeting, I would drink maybe once a week if I was at a party, something like that. You know, like every Saturday night, I found myself with a group of people, and we'd drink some beer then. Mm-hmm. It was only a social environment that I would be drinking, maybe some rum, something like that, if I was tired of the crap American beer that I knew about at the time. But the people at the Alcoholics Anonymous meeting could not accept that you could have a beer once a week in a social environment and it not be an addiction. They couldn't accept that you could ever have a beer and it not be addicting. Mm. So they'd be insisting that I quit when I have no reason. I mean, what the hell is once a week? I would think that once a week is not even an addiction. If I was smoking cigarettes once a week, how would I consider that an addiction? But they wouldn't accept it. And so they hounded and persisted in berating me over the fact that, look, if I'm going to a party and people are drinking, why can I not drink? Why should I refuse to drink? What is the downside?
So AA has kind of hijacked the word sober. You sound to me like a fairly sober person. Even though you're drinking now, you're still sober. You could probably legally drive a car in many countries. And so that's sober. AA means abstinent. And not everybody can manage a program of abstinence. And there's the two things we've talked about that stops people getting well. The God stuff, and there's a lot of it in AA. It's a spiritual program of recovery. So if you are a naturalist, there is no spiritual, right? It's all in here. And the abstinence. And if you can't or don't want to maintain abstinence, then AA is not going to be any good for you. And that's why people have to have a fairly brutal rock bottom like I did. I mean, I ended up virtually homeless. And then I was like, okay, which way's Mecca? You show me which way to point and I'll do it. But, I've been trying to find help for a long time. And what I would like is for people to be given earlier intervention options. And there's a lot of therapies. There's a thing called motivational interviewing, which achieves what a lot of what happens in AA meetings, which is persuading people that they maybe are in denial and that they can change and they can find ways to change. And motivational interviewing has been judged as the most effective intervention for people with a drink problem, higher than AA. That's been used at the moment in a couple of different surveys of what works and what doesn't. So that's essentially a more modern version of helping people with the initial desire to change and persuading people that they can make changes in their lives. And it's more science-based. And there's a thing called smart recovery, which uses cognitive behavioral therapy, which is a more up-to-date version of how you might address personal issues. In AA, it's the 12 steps, which were written in, which were published in 1939 and haven't changed since, not a word. Cognitive behavioral therapy came around in the early 50s and has been developed since then. And one of the interesting things there is in AA, there's lots of, you must not do this, you mustn't take a drink, we must remain sober, and we no half measures, you've got to go all in for this thing. And CBT doesn't take that view. CBT says, embrace the gray areas. CBT, Albert Ellis famously called it masturbation, when black and white thinking. And black and white thinking today, we know, isn't very healthy. And there's a lot of black and white thinking in AA. And that's what was happening to you when you were there, was that black and white, on or off. And we also know alcoholism is not an on-off condition. It's a continuum. We know that now.
And not only that, but the use of alcohol itself. I mean, it's different than, say, cigarettes. I mean, because nobody has a cigarette only after sex, for example. I mean, there's not like, I only smoke, on Saturday nights once, that doesn't happen. That's a, it's a different kind of, it's a very powerful addiction that I don't think is comparable to alcohol. You can, and even the Bible, you have Alcoholics Anonymous is a religious organization, and they promote belief in this higher power and everything. And of course, it's the Christian God more often than not. So why don't these people refer to the Bible where it says, you know, it's okay to have alcohol, but don't drink to excess. I mean, so there's moderation detailed in the Bible. So how are they being so, how are they enforcing this dichotomy? How are they going against their own scriptures in this case?
That's one of the interesting things about it, is it's a closed system of thinking. So there is, AA involves thought reform, but it's quite kindly thought reform. It's loving thought reform.
Irrelevant it is, being my own personal experience.
But
you know, at the time when I was being harassed by these AA people, I was with this social circle, and we would have a very enjoyable, you know, Saturday night at a kegger or a cocktail party at somebody's house every weekend, you know, or you know, a camping event or something like that. And there's like kegs of beer and nothing else to drink, and I'm having pleasant conversation with everybody. I'm going to have a beer while I'm talking to everybody, even though it's not particularly good beer. What the hell else am I going to drink? You know, Gatorade, you know, which I do on occasion. I mean, this could just as well be a Gatorade this evening, because I don't have this, this need that these people were insisting that you had to have. If you ever had a single beer, it had to be because you were addicted to it. And why can't you put it down? And it wouldn't accept it. Well, because I don't have a reason to. But the irony is that when I got out of that circle, when I moved away, I quit drinking beer, because I only knew about that, you know, then American Pilsner, the Anheuser-Busch Natural Light, Coors Light, Bud Light, all these sorts of, that's not good. Why would I drink that?
So there's something very interesting about all that as well, which is the AA program is 80 years old, and even it's kind of obscured the Sinclair method, because the Sinclair method doesn't need abstinence. So nobody in AA is going to turn around to you and say, have you tried the Sinclair method? Because AA is this kind of little closed system of thought where you do need to buy into some element of it. And one of those elements is abstinence. So no one's going to say, well, you can try this and it will help. AA is not interested in sharing a general message of recovery. AA only shares its message of recovery.
And, that was something I wanted to ask you about. Mm-hmm. When you mentioned before about how Alcoholics Anonymous is, I think you said, blocking some of these alternative methods. I'd like to hear more about that.
Well, it's an epistemology thing. It comes from the... who's the American founder of psychology, William James, and a lot of it's to do with that kind of William James American pragmatism idea that if it ain't broke, don't fix it. So it's this kind of huge trundling machine that does what it does, and it's not interested in alternatives. And you can get leaflets in AA meetings for all kinds of interest groups, for women, for young people, for old people, for people in the services. They'll never do a leaflet. They haven't done one for atheists yet, which they should do. They've been trying to for 40 years, but it's such a slow-moving organization, they can't get one together. And they'll never do one on alternatives to AA. Now, you've got to remember, AA gets so much support in the media and in movies and Hollywood. When will a character in a soap opera get sober using the Sinclair method? When will a character in a movie find recovery through smart recovery? They won't. It's all AA. It's one-way traffic, because it's become the dominant cultural sort of meme. So AA ought to publish something that says, try this as well, but it won't. They never will.
The sad thing is you're talking about using Hollywood culture as if that's descriptive of American, and I guess you're correct in some respects that it is. But you look at Hollywood culture, and of course they're like the center of chemical addiction and every other type of addictive behavior being glorified in some way on a number of different levels, and not just alcoholism. But I mean, everybody who's famous has checked into the Betty Ford Clinic, haven't they? I mean, everybody who's famous has had a string of arrests for drunk driving somebody else's stolen car or whatever, or every child actor has at least. Yeah, of course, they're also, you know, leading in like Scientology and
yeah. Oh, that's my favorite subject. Once I got into thought reform, so yeah, it's kind of kind thought reform with health benefits. And I started reading about, so I watched Going Clear, which isn't available in this country, in the UK, in the original form. You still can't get the book. You can't get Leah Remini's book. It's not out over here because of our libel laws. But that's really interesting because it's a similar kind of, there's a common joke in AA that I needed a good brainwashing, you know, and I kind of did. You do, because if you're having trouble controlling your behaviors, you need to start by regaining control of your thinking. So in some ways it's helpful, but you know, a lot of it boils down to our reward systems, and we're only just beginning to understand those. Hollywood understands our reward systems very well. The video games industry understands our reward systems extremely well. We have long, long evolutionary reasons why if you fire a digital gun and it shoots a pixelated bullet and it hits something on the screen, you get a little shot of serotonin or you get a reward there. And that comes from throwing a spear at a passing hog in the jungle 2 million years ago. And there's a lot of interesting research being done on alcohol. What you're drinking there is fermented fruit. And fermented fruit has a long backstory. If you imagine a couple of million years ago, our descendants probably knew each other in the same patch of forest in Africa. And we're feeding on ripe berries they're going to rot in 24 hours in the jungle. But the berries have got a little bit of yeast in them. And that yeast is feeding on the alcohol, feeding on the sugar, turning it into alcohol, and just keeping that berry ripe for another 4 or 6 hours, giving off alcohol, which is a very potent, very sort of volatile substance. And you and I, as monkeys, are climbing along the tree branch, smelling this stuff. That's where we are really finely tuned to those reward systems, and it works with sex, it works with sports, it works with Hollywood. McDonald's do the same thing. You know, the sugar in the Coke, the fat and the salt. We crave salt because we need salt, and there's no salt in the jungle where we evolved, because salt dissolves in water and it just runs through into the soil. So we really have to crave salt in order to get enough.
Yeah, a moment of correction on this one thing. This is not wine, so it's not fermented fruit. I think that beer is kind of fascinating because it's a...
What's a hop?
Exactly. So
it's the fermented fruit.
I understand it. The anthropological ancestry of beer is that when we started our cultivations and everything, we started, you know, like throwing the refuse of our, you know, wheat and barley and everything into the pond, whatever, it ferments in the pond. And so they're drinking naturally distilled beer.
Yeah.
Just started doing that as a practice. So this is, I believe I read somewhere that this is the oldest invention man has ever made.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I think is so fascinating about it. We've been doing this for thousands of years. And look at all the different brands and different styles that we have. And as I said, I quit drinking for, I don't know, 8 or 9 years, because all I was familiar with was American Pilsner. And when somebody turned me on to stouts and porters and weiss beer, different types of ales, and I could experiment in a broader spectrum, then I started to appreciate how there's so many different ways of tweaking this a little bit here or there and looking for that perfect mix.
Mm.
I think it's kind of fascinating. We've been at this for thousands of years and yet...
Yeah, more. About 10,000. They found it. There's the first hunter-gatherer hilltop communities in Turkey, they just found that there's a great paper on it, on rituals and brewing, doing exactly what you described, rotting fruit into a big bowl, waiting for it to really ripen up. And it's the kind of Turkish version of Stonehenge, and it's about 10,000 years old. It's the dawn of agriculture. We've been doing it a long, long, long time.
And if I could say one more thing about it.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
When we have, and my apologies, I'm interrupting you to talk about something completely irrelevant. I'm actually praising the alcohol at that. But the thing is that we talk about, you know, there's a style of making it perfect, right? There's just that right mixture for making very good beer. And people have also in wine, they make that very good wine. You don't think about, you know, Dom Perignon or anything like this as being something that a drunk would have, right? I mean, you have very expensive wines, very good wines, because they go well with meals, they go well with occasions. You don't expect, you know, there's not a wino sitting in, you know, drinking Dom Perignon. There's a reason that people craft these things to be as good as they are. And there's a way to have these without it being this terrible addiction. And I wish that the Alcoholics Anonymous people would have understood that, you know, you can appreciate a finely crafted whatever. You know, just because it has alcohol in it doesn't mean that I'm an alcoholic.
Yeah. AA, probably the thing about AA is it can't and it won't change, because this is why it's interesting epistemologically. They have a sacred set text. And as somebody who believes in science, like obviously Darwin is possibly the greatest English scientist of all time, but he got things wrong. There are bits in, you know, on the Origin of Species where he makes mistakes, and we can revise that. If you believe in a sacred set text, whether you're a Scientologist or a Mormon or a recovering alcoholic, sooner or later you're going to hit trouble, because knowledge is a fluid thing. We inch closer towards the truth, and gradually over the last 80 years, much of what AA says is true, but not for the reasons it gives, because they were making a real good best guess, and they did a great job. And it was cutting edge 1930s mental health technology. And my argument is that, great, but we can do better. And it's the success of it, the ongoing success of it, is it stopping better things like the Sinclair Method, the use of naltrexone. Life Ring is another group that you can join. There are women-only groups. There's lots and lots of online recovery.
What is the success that you, the 1930s cutting edge behavioral successes?
It helps people to stop, and there had been other groups that help people to stop. There was one called the Washington.
Is it because it is a group? Is it the group support?
It's the group thing. Yeah, it's the group think, and the fact that you get a self control mechanism, which is the sort of the steps, and you just find a higher power.
I'm confused. I'm sorry to be interrupting you. That's right. This often, but I'm confused. How do you get a self-help mechanism if you have to constantly bow to this higher power and claim that you don't have
means? You don't have the power. You give the power to your higher power, and the higher power makes the decisions for you. It's very good. It works very well. I mean, my problem with it is the higher power doesn't exist. We know that. And you can't say that in a meeting, because there are people whose lives they feel depend on this. So I've had quite a lot of criticism, because I've written a blog that says, you know what, this higher power I was living by for 14 years, it doesn't exist. I read The God Delusion, and I saw Andy Thompson's Why We Believe in God's video, and it blew my mind, and it killed my higher power. I lost my higher power when I read Bart Ehrman's The Historical Jesus as part of my step 11, because in step 11, you explore what your higher power is. So I read On the Historicity of Jesus by Bart Ehrman, and I realized that Christians have got it all wrong. If Jesus did exist, he was nothing like contemporary Christians think he was.
Let me ask you about that and this is a different subject entirely, that's cool. I realize. It may frustrate some people watching this who are interested in the primary subject. I promise I will get back to that. But on this podcast, I have interviewed every mythicist I know of. I mean, every Jesus mythicist. And of course, they all bring up Bart Ehrman as being the one guy who still maintains that, you know, who doesn't believe that Jesus was a God or a prophet of God or that there is a God, but who still believes that Jesus is a historic character. You know, of course, conventional historians generally do, because they don't question what they've been taught. And, you know, and mythicism has come up several times on this podcast. And I'm interested in what you read about, you know, Ehrman's impression on a historical Jesus. And you're describing that if Jesus existed, he was not the guy we expect him to be. And as a mythicist myself, that's exactly my point. that the Jesus we expect to find in history, if there was one, isn't who we expect to find.
Well, here's why it's important, because Alcoholics Anonymous was founded in a thing called the Oxford Group, which was a huge mass movement in the 30s in the United States and worldwide. And their whole aim was to be was to recreate first century Christianity as if you were a direct follower of Jesus and the apostles. So I read Bart Ehrman based on the title alone. I thought, I want to know, and there's another good book by A.N. Wilson, which is a bit older. I thought, I, assuming at the time, as I did, that Jesus did exist, and I'm kind of undecided on that, I don't think it matters, really.
I agree with you there.
And we'll never know, but it's an interesting debate. And assuming he did, one thing I think we can be pretty sure of is that the Christian view of Jesus is completely historically invalid. Now, I'm a cultural historian, so that's important to me. I cannot follow something, whether it's AA that was founded in the Oxford Group or anything, that's if it's historically invalid, then it's not true, and I can't, you know, I can't do that. So I read it as a historian, and I was really surprised by it, how wrong people have been, and how those myths and the real things that Christ said that were important to him, you know, about going against your family, all those 20th century values are totally skewed. And he was really a sort of a revolutionary figure, and so that was the beginning of a long process of deprogramming, really. And I realized that AA was founded on a myth of what it was supposed to be, which is largely to do with a lot of the letters of Paul, Corinthians, and things like that. That's what where they took quite a lot of the ideas in the big book from, or the principles anyway. That and William James.
And okay.
The tenets of the Oxford Group.
We've only got like 5 minutes left, so I would like you to summarize what's good and bad about Alcoholics Anonymous, and what alternatives we have, just in a summary statement to close it.
It's a good place to go. You can meet people who will identify with the idea of being an uncontrolled drunk and who are sober. And if you look online, you'll find atheist groups, and there's sooner or later there'll be a schism in AA between the people of faith and the atheists. And I think the recovery world will be healthier for it. So I would encourage people to go online. The internet is a game changer. The internet is killing Scientology. The internet has made Mormonism both the fastest growing and fastest shrinking religion in history. And the internet is changing the world of recovery. And there's some very good bloggers. There's a great one, a guy from London called Recovering from Recovery. And for many people in AA are questioning it. Many people are struggling to get it. And there's never been a better time to try and find recovery, because you can do the traditional route, but you can go online and you can learn about naltrexone, the Sinclair method. You can learn about smart recovery. You can learn about the online groups. There's a women's group called Soberistas. They all have fantastic websites, and they're 24/7 support, and they're more contemporary in their outlook, and they're growing very quickly because there's a demand for it. And AA is in this kind of dilemma, because it can't change, because it has a sacred text. So it's actually, the numbers in AA have stayed the same since about 1991. Population of the United States has grown substantially since the early 1990s, but the population of AA's remained about 1.5 million in America. And so that tells you something's going on. And I think the future's bright. But what's interesting about this subject for me as a cultural historian is we are at a moment of schism, and it's exactly the same things that you do when you the great work you do talking the truth to people about the history of what they hold so dear to their heart, and you're trying to sort of burst that bubble in Texas and areas like that. And it's a similar thing in the recovery world, because it's very emotional, people are very close to it, but there's a bubble there to be sort of very gently deflated to allow other light into the room based on science, not faith, I think. That's the summary of it.
Okay. So my apologies once again for insensitively sitting here and having a beer in front of me while talking about how I'm not an alcoholic.
Don't worry about it.
I realize how insensitive all that is. I did make the concession, though, that regarding cigarettes, I know that, yeah, you know, I can't even, you know, I can't even take a puff off one because there's the risk of becoming addicted all over again. So I understand where you're coming from on that. And once again, I want to thank you for being on, and I very much appreciated your presentation. And where can people in your area see you giving presentations of this kind?
Sure. I have a blog. It's John Sleeper, JonSleeper.wordpress.com. And they're all on there. And I'm doing various skeptics in the pub meetings. And I'm doing one in London as well, at the London Atheist Activist Group in March. So I just pop around.
When is that in March? Because I'll be in London myself in March.
It's on my calendar. I can't remember. I'm terribly sorry. I've burned away my memory cells with cannabis as well as alcohol. So yeah, early March. But I'll send you the details. It's on the blog too.
Well, the issues with cannabis will, I'm sure, be another podcast.
Yeah, very happy. I mean, I think what's great is the discussion is happening. If you're in a healthy place, if the discussion is happening, whether whatever it is, because it's discussion and information that is freeing, ultimately. So I'm very grateful that you had me on the show.
Oh, well, no, thank you very much. Appreciate it. I'm going to go ahead and close it out. As I said, if you all of the links that you feel relevant, inform me, and I will go ahead and put them into the description. I'm going to close it up tonight. So thank you once again for watching.